Being separated. Okay. I just been informed that we are recording. Okay. So the states can be separable. So separable states are convex combinations of tensor products of one density matrix per subsystem. Or they can be what's called entangled, and entangled is everything which is not separable. So whereas it is relatively easy to detect whether a state is in a pure state or a mixed state, because you know you can easily see if a matrix is a one-dimensional projector or not, it is much harder to decide whether a state is entangled or not. So deciding, you know, if I give you a state, telling me if it is entangled or separable, that is a very hard problem, and the computation is very involved. So people are searching for, you know, criteria to detect, you know, when I give you a state, if this state is entangled or not, or separable. Okay, now these notions, pure versus mixed, and entangled versus separable, although they both involve linear combinations and so on, you know, the interplay between the two, it's a bit subtle. Namely, there exists, you know, the pure states could be separable. So this would happen if this vector psi is a tensor product. So then if I take the wrong psi, this would be a tensor product or not. So a pure state which is not separable, well, it can be obtained by taking you know, linear combination here and just, you know, taking a linear projector on this psi, you know, which is a complicated linear combination. Now, the same holds for mixed states. Mixed states could be separable. And this is if the state, you know, if the vector psi I, it's a tensor product of, you know, one vector per each subsystem. So, you know, then I can build a mixed state like this, which would be separable or not. Okay, so the interplay between separability versus mixity, it's a bit complicated. Okay, so it turns out that, you know, so a system, you know, it's in a state, however, there are many states which are equivalent. And the equivalent states in this Hilbert space, you know, of a system can be obtained from a given state B by a local change of basis. So meaning that I take each subsystem, so there are D subsystems, you know, and I change individually base in each of them. So this means that essentially I take the state B, you know, and I conjugate it with a U and U dog, where U, it's a certain kind of unitary operator, namely it's a unitary operator which is a tensor product of unitary operators per subsystem. So it is expected that such a state, you know, will be, you know, this B index U will be equivalent with the state B, you know, because it's just obtained by, you know, changing bases in each subsystem. So state properties of a state like entanglement should not depend on this, you know, on the particular representative I pick under this local change of basis. So we expect this, you know, entanglement to survive averaging over these local unitary transformations. So starting from a state B, you know, and an observable A, both of them fixed, I would expect that the entanglement properties survive the averaging under the U. So I can go over the orbit BU and integrate. So objects like the trace of A, U, B, U, DAG, you know, this average of this trace should capture some information about the entanglement of the state. Or perhaps, you know, one could look at the higher moments where I take this trace to some power n and I average over the group U. So these objects, you know, they are expected to capture features like entanglement of the system. So the physical question is, can we say anything about a state B, assuming that we know an observable A, you know, I give you an observable, and then I give you how these moments A, U, B, U dagger to some power, you know, the distress to some power, average over the unitary group. If I give you the value of this guy and the observable A, can you infer anything about the state B? And namely, can you say anything about its entanglement properties? So, of course, you know that can be translated in, you know, for those of you who already know the Harishchandra Titson-Zuber integral, that is just a problem of actually computing a Harishchandra, it is on like Zuberi like integral. So the formulation will be the following. I'm interested in the generating function of the moments. So the generating function of the moments will be the expectation of the exponential of this you know, trace with some parameter t here. So, you know, variable which just serves to, you know, index this this cumulant. Or so if I look at the generating function of the moment, I could equivalently look at generating function of connected moment, which is the log of it, which is this guy here, the exponential, or the dc. So this exponential, you know, this generating function of the connected moments will be a series in T, you know, this parameter T. And the nth Taylor term here is called the cumulant or a connected moment, you know. So instead of looking at just the moments, it is sometimes, you know, more informative to look at these connected moments or these cumulants. They capture the same information, essentially, maybe arranged in a different manner. So the purpose would be, you know, for us to compute these cumulants, you know, so this, you know, objects here, you know, which I get after averaging over U. So this is a bit of a hard problem. So one could try, okay, instead of actually computing them, you know, to derive some information, looking at how these guys behave for large systems. So there is, you know, hidden in this integral, there is a parameter, which is the size of the subsystem, this N. And I can try to understand what happens for the this cumulant when I send this N to be large. So I consider a large subsystem. So my big system, it's formed of several large subsystems. And I can try to understand the behavior, the asymptotic behavior of these cumulants in the large N limit. Okay. So this, you know, in order for us to, you know, exploit this information, first, you know, we need to derive, you know, how this asymptotic should look like. And this comes to studying the asymptotic expansion of this tensor Harish-Chandra-Etchison-Zuber integral. So in order to understand how this tensor, how this large N expansion works, let's first build the objects, you know, which arise in this large N expansion. And first we are preoccupied by what's called trace invariants. So these are invariant quantities that I can build out of a matrix. So let's consider basis in Hilbert space of an individual subsystem. So this is something which are indexed by I index C. So see here, index is the subsystem. You know? So I have a basis in the subsystem one, a basis in the subsystem two, and so on. So then I get the tensor product basis, which is a, you know, basis in the full space. That just be something which I'll denote I1 to ID. So it is the tensor product of D individual basis elements, one in each subsystem. So an operator in the big Hilbert space, well, I can write this matrix element in this tensor product basis. So this will be like a matrix which will have D incoming indices, say I, and D outgoing indices, say J, you know. Okay, so these matrix elements, they can be represented. I will build invariant quantities under unitary, you know, local unitary transformations. So how do I write them in terms of these matrix elements? Well, I can associate an invariant to a duple, I mean, you know, D permutations sigma. So if I take a permutation sigma one and the one sigma two and up to sigma D, one invariant which I, you know, I can associate to this duple of permutations, the following invariant, you know, I call it the generalized trace of sigma or of A indexed by sigma. So this is a sum over all the indices of a product of matrix entries. And then I use the sigma function, the sigma permutation to identify indices, to contract indices pairwise. So I say that the outgoing indices I, they are contracted with the incoming indices J index sigma of S. You know, so these contractions of indices, they respect the colors, the position of the index C here. And the sigma tells me, well, I start from a certain matrix element S and I go to sigma of S following this color. So this kind of invariance, you know, first of all, they are clearly invariants. If I conjugate by a local unitary, you see that this identification here will make that I always get products of unitaries acting on the same indices, which will, you know, U times U dag, which will cancel. So these invariants, they obey a graphical representation, which is very, comes in very handy. So let me represent a matrix element as a rod here. This is a black rod. And it has on one end a big white vertex here. So this is associated to the outgoing indices I. And it has a small black vertex here, which is associated to the incoming indices J. So a matrix element will be a black rod, and it will have D outgoing guys and D incoming guys. And because my contractions here, they respect the position, I can color the indices by the position. So I will say that this index corresponding to the first, you know, the I1 here, this will be colored blue, and the I2 will be colored red, and the J1 will be colored blue, and the J2 will be colored red also. And this is for each matrix element. Now, taking a product of these matrix elements means that I have a product of, you know, I have a certain number of these rods here, and each of these identifications, well, I can represent it as an edge which connects an index, you know, an outgoing index I with an incoming index J. So the contractions here are just represented as these edges. And you know, the rule is that the I on the vertex S, so the rod S corresponding to the matrix element S, this index I1 will contract with the index J1 on the matrix element sigma 1 of S. So this is how the matrix, the permutation sigma 1 encodes connections, you know, contractions between indices. I have a sigma 2 which does the same. So I also have red edges in this story going from I. If I have more indices, then I get more colors. So each of these invariants can be represented like such a colored graph, you know, which is made of these black rods. You know, each of them represents a matrix element. So this would be, you know, matrix element 1, the matrix element 2, and the matrix element 3. Each of them has two incoming and two outgoing indices. And here I represented the invariant associated to these two permutations. So one of them, sigma 1, it's the permutation 1 to 3, because you see 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 1 on the color 1, on the color. Whereas the red, it's the permutation 1, 2, and 3. So 3 goes to 3 here, you see. And then 1 goes to 2, and 2 goes to 1. OK. So you see that for every double of permutation, I can have such a drawing. It turns out that you know, this drawing, they form a basis in the space of invariants. You know? So these trace invariants will form an algebraic basis in the space of invariants. OK. So notice that, I mean, these are pretty complicated objects. You know, they are graphs, you know. So if I have, for instance, you know, only with two colors, I can get here trivalent graphs, which can be very, very complicated. However, there is one case in which these invariants are relatively simple. So imagine that all my permutations, sigma c, are exactly the same cyclic permutation. So this will just represent this invariant associated to the cyclic permutation. It will just be the trace of a power n of the matrix, because the associated graph is quite simple. You know, it's a rod, and then it has the edges, parallel edges going to a next rod, and then the outputs of that one, edges which go to the next rod, and so on and so forth, and then this cycles back. So this is just a trace of the power n of the matrix. So, you know, among these invariants, you know, some of them are simple. No, of course, typically they are much more complicated than this. Okay, so now that you know, we understand what these trace invariants are, we are able to state, you know, the main technical result, which we'll use later. And this technical result has to do with the asymptotic expansion of this cumulants in the Harish-Chandra Isisson-Zuber integral. So it can be shown that this cumulant of order n, it's a sum of permutations sigma and tau. And here I get the trace invariant associated to sigma of the A, this is the observable, and the trace invariant associated to tau of B, and this is the state. And then this product of trace invariants, it comes multiplied by, you know, some scaling factor in n, and some explicit function here, which is n independent. Okay, so at leading order, we have such an expansion. I mean, what is you know, more important? It's you know, that this s factor here, it's a known function, and also f, it's a known function. You know, I mean, they're a bit complicated, you know. So for instance, you know, I have an explicit formula for this scaling, which depends on the 2 to the power of permutation sigma and tau, and has this particular form. You know, it has to do with the number of transitivity classes of the groups generated by, you know, subsets of permutations. So here I just take the permutation sigma times tau, and this generates a you know, this generates a number of transitivity classes, and their number is this number here, and then I subtract twice the number of the transitivity classes of the group generated by all the permutations. Okay, so this is a particular formula. It's analytic. I mean, you know, it's maybe not very simple, but it's an analytic formula. Now, f of sigma tau, it's an independent function. It's an independent function. And it's now, it has kind of a complicated formula here. It's not very informative. However, these two things, sigma and f, both of them simplify if sigma and tau are both the same cyclic permutation. All the sigmas were the same cyclic permutation, then also this invariant was simplifying a lot, you know. So if it happens, you know, for the term in which all the sigmas and all the c are the same, you know, are one cycle, and respectively the toes are actually sigma minus ones, then, well, it turns out that this scaling factor here is trivially just, you know, d times n. And this function, quite complicated, is exactly one, you know. So if you look at this very complicated sum here, you'll notice that in the case in which all the sigmas are the same cyclic permutation and the toes are the rim, then you only get one contribution in this, and everything conspires to just give a factor one. No, so these two things simplify a lot in this case when all the sigmas are, you know, the same cycle and toes the inverses.
Okay. Yeah, sorry to interrupt, Razvan. It's Jamie here.
Yes.
So I mean, that's F of sigma tau. It's something can be expressed in terms of the Weingarten function. Is that what you're going to talk about?
So this F of sigma tau, it is related to the Weingarten functions.
Yeah.
I will not insist too much on that.
Okay.
Insist that these functions are a bit complicated, but they do simplify in some cases. And it turns out that physically, you know, at least in some circumstances, the physical interesting cases are these cases in which these functions are actually very simple. You know, they have a complicated structure. So this complicated sum you see here, it's about on partitions and so on and so forth. So that's a bit of a monster, but it's quite simple in some cases. And turns out that I can do something with the cases when they are simple, you know, physically.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Okay. So now, you know, how do we use this, you know, this asymptotic expansion of this cumulants in order to do a bit of physics? So the idea is that, I mean, here I'm not yet finished because this is an asymptotic expansion of the cumulant. It is valid for any, you know, matrix A and any matrix B, no? So what I want is to choose some matrices which correspond to states and other matrices which correspond to observable, you know? So in particular, I need to make some scaling assumption of how the invariance, this trace invariance for the matrices A and B scale with the size of the system N. So typically what you will do, you'll assume that, okay, at large N, I will get some scaling factor, you know, such that the rescaled invariant goes to a finite limit. Now, so this is kind of, you know, you assume you have an asymptotic scaling, meaning that you have this S is, you know, I denoted here S of tau, you know, this scaling powers, which make that the rescaled invariant has a finite limit. Okay, so if I use this rescaled invariants, then at the larger limit, you see that I will get distribution from the cumulant and then these explicit scaling factors, and then here just the rescaled invariants, trace A and trace B, you know? So in order to understand the leading order behavior of this formula, it's not enough to just have the asymptotic of the cumulant. I need to also assume to have an ansatz for the asymptotics of the trace invariants. So now such a formula will have various what we would call large N regimes. So what would be a large N regime? So this would be a choice of two constants, delta and gamma, such that essentially this cumulant rescaled in an appropriate manner has a good large N limit. So this object here, you see that all the scaling in N is factored in front. So I am searching for numbers gamma and delta such that if I rescale maybe with some factor little n times gamma, this cumulant, then up to a global scaling in delta, this object has a finite limit when n goes to infinity. And if this happens, so this finite limit will just be a sum over some subclass of this invariance, sigma and tau, which have some property, you know. And namely, I will say that this property is that, you know, this, you know, there is some quantity depending on sigma and tau, which is zero, you know. So this is this quantity which just sees the scalings here. So, you know, this is a subclass of invariants which respect a certain constraint, you know? So in a large N regime at leading order, I will just see a part of invariants, not everybody, you know? So in principle, I mean, this regimes, what will distinguish them is what are the invariants which I see at large N, you know? So which are the guys which respect such a condition, you know, which will appear in this sum at leading order. Regimes will correspond to various subclasses of invariant which I can explore, you know, which I can see in this large ending. So why is such a regime interesting? Well, if I have a regime, if I look back at my Harishchandra integral, you will see that in fact, you know, the existence of such a regime implies that if I take, you know, the Harishchandra integral up to maybe a rescaling of the factor t by some n, I take a logarithm, so this goes to connected functions, and up to some global scaling in D, which is this one over n to the delta, object will have a finite limit. So in a regime, you know, I arrange my scaling such that this, you know, cumulant generating function has, you know, up to some global scaling a finite limit, and at leading order, I just get a subclass of the graphs, you know? Okay, so various regimes, you know, presumably I can distinguish the regimes because if I have many graphs which respect this kind of condition, then I'll have a rich regime, you know, with many contributions. And if I have few invariants which contribute, then I would have, you know, much fewer, you know, guys present in this sum. So, you know, presumably one would be able to distinguish as a function of the particular class of leading order invariants, one could distinguish in this between among these regimes. Okay, so now I will discuss, you know, what are some physically reasonable ansatz for the asymptotic scaling of invariants, and how can they, you know, how can I use this asymptotic, you know, of the cumulant in order to say things about the entanglement of states. Okay, So there are two things in this story. One is the observable A, and the other one is the state P, and things should be treated slightly differently. So for an adapted set of observables for this multipartite quantum system would be to consider a local observable. So a local observable would be essentially a tensor product of a small observable per subsystem. So imagine that A, it's some tensor product of matrices AC, one per subsystem, and each of them it's of low rank, you know. So they are such that, you know, if these are low rank, it means that essentially all these trace invariants, if I evaluate in them on a low rank matrix, they'll be of order one. So which means that asymptotically, the asymptotic scaling here is essentially zero. Okay, so this is for the observable. So this is supposed to be something, you know, of low rank per subsystem. Now, how about a state B? Well, I mean, for the state B, you know, the asymptotic scaling, essentially it can do two things. It can either separate between the various subsystems. So it was something separated, would essentially be something which only sees one subsystem. Or so, you know, this could be a separated scaling, or it could be an entangled scaling, so it should be something which doesn't separate the systems. So it's essentially, it's something which mixes the systems, let's say it mixes two subsystems, or mixes maybe three subsystems or more subsystems, you know. So in principle, the asymptotic ansatz here will have some entangled part, this one which mixes, and some separated part, which is the one which doesn't mix it, you know. So a natural scaling assumption, it's an assumption in which I have essentially two parameters. One which says, okay, how much is this, you know, asymptotic scaling entangles the system and how much it keeps them separated. Okay, so in particular, you know, I will introduce a family of states, and this family of states, I mean, it's a bit complicated, it's a kind of, it's my technical slide, you know. So in order to understand a bit how these states are built, you know, let's take one individual Hilbert space of on one subsystem, and I divide it in a product of three parts. One part, I will essentially use it to put a low rank projector on. On one part, so so this would be the H1, you know, it's a low rank projector. On another part of the subsystem, this would be like this HC, I will put just an identity matrix. So this is something, you know, the one-dimensional projector is something which I will represent like this. An identity is something which I represent like just one index which is transmitted. And then, well, the rest of the system, I will use it to entangle with the other subsystems. So this part of the system essentially is destined to be entangled with the other subsystems. This part is separated, and this part is low rank. Okay, so what I will do, I will build out of this, you know, I'll build the following density matrix. So the part which is rank one on each subsystem, I just, you know, put it a rank one, you know, one dimensional projector. The part which is the identity, I will just transmit as the identity per subsystem. And the entangled part, well, the entangled part, what will it do? I will identify the indices, you know, pairwise between subsystems. So this last part, essentially, it's responsible, you know, for the what goes between subsystems here. So the drawing up here represents essentially all the subsystems, you know, and this thing goes between subsystems, it entangles them, whereas this one conserves the subsystem. So this is separated. Okay, so on the B1 part, I will just put low dimensional projector. On the thing which is transmitted, I will just put an identity. And on the entangled part, well, I will take a pure entangled state. So the fact that it's pure, you know, makes it a bit simpler to deal with because it's one dimensional projector, but I take something which is entangled before, you know, taking the projector, and the entanglement essentially forces me, you know, mixes the subsystems here. Okay, so this kind of state, I mean, it is a physical state, and it has the following features. You know, if you look at its asymptotic scaling when you send n to infinity, you will have, it will have the following behavior. You know, it will be a two parameter family, you know, so the scaling with n, you know, will be represented by two parameters, beta and epsilon. Essentially, one of them measures how strongly the system is separated. So this is something which just is each subsystem individually. You see the thing, I sum here over subsystems C of something which just is subsystem by subsystem. So this is a separated part in the asymptotic scaling. And then I have a second parameter, epsilon, which measures how entangled this state is. And this is something which sees pairs of subsystems. So you see that here, this is an object which essentially measures something which requires both subsystems, you know, to be present. So this mixes the subsystems tau one, sorry, C1 and C2. So in the plane of epsilon and beta, I will have here, I have a family of states, and they are, they can be represented as this triangle here. So I can cover this entire triangle of parameters epsilon and beta by this family of states I presented, and essentially they range from purely separated states, which correspond to this beta equal one, to maximally entangled states. They are the states which have the maximal possible beta, and essentially almost anything in between, more or less entangled, more or less separated states. Okay, so I will, for these states, because I have a good answer for the asymptotic scaling, I can plug them in my larger asymptotic of the cumulants in this HCIZ integral, and I can try to see if those cumulants inform me about this scaling parameters beta and epsilon. Looking at the cumulants, can I infer anything about the scaling parameters? And turns out that actually I can, if my state is entangled enough. So if essentially this entangled parameter epsilon dominates over the separated parameter beta, then the cumulants of my Harishchandra integral simplify enormously. So in this class of scaling here, turns out that at reading order, I get up only one contribution in this cumulants essentially. It comes from the, all the permutations, which are all equal for all the colors. So all the sigma c's are equal such that, all the toes are sigma minus one. So this is exactly the case, if you remember, in which the asymptotic of the Harishchand of the cumulant was simplifying a lot. It was the case where essentially the F function was one and the scaling function, the scaling was simple and so on. So it turns out that in this entangled regime, it is the simplest regime. It is the regime in which just the trivial case contributes and in which the large asymptotic of the cumulant has this particularly simple form, appropriately scaled. This guy equals n minus one factorial times just the trace of the a to the n times trace of b to the n, So in particular, one can conclude that if b respects this asymptotic scaling ansatz, which I assume here, and I pick a local observable a, and I'm able in some way to measure that the cumulants behave like this, I can conclude that the parameter epsilon should be, it's definitely larger than beta and is definitely strictly positive. So this allows me, seeing this asymptotic behavior of the cumulants allows me to conclude that the state B must be entangled, So this provides an entanglement criterion, if you want. I can take my state, I take low rank observables on it. If I don't see the scaling of the cumulant, it doesn't mean the state is not entangled. It just means I cannot detect it. But if I see this, then I can conclude that the state is definitely entangled. So this large N asymptotic provides an entanglement criterion for this multipartite quantum system. Okay, so essentially this entanglement criterion, what I stated, if for a local observables, under averaging over the local unitary transformations, the cumulants behave in this particular manner, this is essentially the simplest thing you can see, then the state B is necessarily entangled. Okay, so just some remarks. This entangled regime, although it sounds complicated because it's entangled, it's in fact the simplest large N regime possible. It is the one which has the fewest leading order contributions, and this is why it has this very particularly simple form, Now, you could say, okay, but all your entanglement criterion, which tells you that, there is a regime in which this cumulant simplifies enormously. And if you see that, it means you are entangled. This is strongly predicated on the asymptotic scaling ansatz you made. So for the observable, okay, we all agree that should be low rank. But how about the state? You have these two parameter families, but there are a priori many other possibilities of, asymptotic scalings of states. This is an ongoing process to try to generalize beyond this particular asymptotic scaling this kind of result, and so far it turns out that it's robust. So there are alternative asymptotic scalings in which we can essentially see that if the state is entangled enough, then in a large N limit I will see this drastic simplification in the cumulants and only this family of invariants contributing. And the last point is that the asymptotic behavior I discussed, it's an asymptotic behavior of a system made of D subsystems, each of them of large size. So this is a system with a small number of high dimensional subsystems. A bit more interesting physically, it's a system which is a system of many qubits, so that means many, many subsystems, each of them of relatively small dimension. So the limit in which I was able to analyze these cumulants was a limit in which essentially n was taken large, but d, the rank of these tensors, was kept fixed. And physically, one would be interested also in a regime in which n is fixed to something small, for instance, 2 or 3. And then I take the number of d of subsystems to be very large. It should be kind of the orthogonal system. Okay, so that was about it for my presentation today, and it went much faster than I expected.
Thank you very much. So we have lots of time for questions. Alex.
Yeah, it's Alexander Haag. Thank you for the talk. So your result is a generalization of the matrix Hadrich-Chandra Sigson-Zuber formula in the asymptotic regime, right?
Yes, yes.
So, and for matrix models, it's related to monotone double Hurwitz numbers. Do you have then also a kind of generalization of monotone double Hurwitz numbers?
So these objects here, you know, this Fs and so on, these are some, you know, generalization of this monotone double Hurwitz numbers. You kind of see here, you know, the cycles and so on. So yeah, it's a general, you know, we encounter a generalization of these numbers, and they also count some branch coverings of the sphere and so on.
So you have a geometric interpretation as coverings of some Riemann surfaces and so on.
Exactly. So they have a geometric interpretation also. Yes. So, yeah.
Okay, but it's not like higher dimensional manifolds covering something.
No, so of course, we are hoping to cover higher dimensional manifolds. It turns out that we are still at the surfaces, but we are counting complicated branch coverings.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Welcome.
hi, Razvan. Yeah, so I was wondering, you see your... okay, so the test, how does it compare with other entanglement tests? I mean, how effective is it, for example? I mean,
so it is much less effective than other standard entanglement tests. It also requires to have large systems and so on and so forth. However, it is much cheaper to implement. So it is not the strongest test on the market, but it is the simplest thing to test, actually. So, you know, even experimentally, if you want, I mean, that is the simplest thing you can look at. You know, you can try to look at this behavior of these cumulants. And if you see this something so simple, you can just say, okay, that's entangled. You know, but that's, then you need to work for harder, you know, to actually, you know.
Yes. I mean, also, I mean, I vaguely remember that there are also these entropy tests for entanglement. Does it enter into this somehow,
Hadrich-Chandra integrals? I am not very familiar with the entropy test. I'm very familiar with something which is called the partial transpose test.
So yes, yes.
There are much subtler ways to detect entanglement, which would, in our language, this would come to say, instead of looking at the large M behavior of this integral, I should look at some subsectors. So because, you know, what is it? So this cumulant here, it's a sum over all possible invariants. So this kind of partial transpose tests are something which, you know, select by hand somehow a subclass of these invariants to look at their behavior. Here we kind of use the pneumatic hammer, you know, we said, okay, we just go for the large and limit and we just see where this goes by itself. The smarter tests are the ones which select a subclass of guys here and look at them, and then it's a function of how these guys behave, they conclude, you know, much finer, they detect much finer forms of entanglement.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions, either from the Zoom audience? Any questions there? Okay. Yeah. So I had a question, Razvan, about so there's a lot of similarity just to things in asymptotic freeness, because the A and the B are all asymptotically free in your regime, right? Because you conjugate the B by an independent arbitrary.
I'm sorry, but there are a bit of problems with the sound. So
okay. The light's on. I was just asking about this formula here. You've separated the A's and the B's on the right hand side.
Yes.
You can tell us what H, little H.
Ah, little H here, this little H. So yeah. This is what you ask?
Yeah, right. So what is that? What are the highest order contributions of sigma?
Well, that kind of depends, you know. So as a function of the choices you have for these asymptotic scalings,
yeah,
this can lead to favor other classes of graphs, different classes of graphs, different classes of invariants.
Yes.
Essentially, this regime I'm talking about, it is the absolutely the simplest one. You know, it can be, I mean, under any reasonable circumstances, these invariants will always be included. You know, these particular guys with traces of power to them, which I see in the entanglement regime, will always be included in the leading order. However, typically, this leading order, you know, can contain much more than this. So, you know, there are regimes in which, you know, it contains these guys and a plethora of other contributions. So, in some sense, this entangled regime, it is the simplest one. And then it gets completely drowned in other contributions if I get more complicated, scalings. Now, I can, the kind of stuff which can dominate here, for instance, can be, you know, these graphs, sigma and tau, they can have some planarity property hidden in them, you know. So these cycles, that are the simplest thing you can do, but there are regimes when you can favor something which looks planar in a certain sense and so on and so forth. So you could, for instance, imagine that this is something like the, you know, planar graphs. It's not exactly that, but, you know, it could be the planar graphs, or it could be some other classes of graphs. You know, it could be, something which we call Meloni graphs and so on and so forth. So as a function of the particular choices, this can vary, you know, it will always include this simple guys, but, you know, typically much more than this.
Okay, yeah, so I don't know if, can somebody turn the camera over to the board on the right here? It just happens to be a picture here. Where's the lights? Yeah, so, I can't tell if the camera's... Oh. Ah.
Okay. Can you bring the camera close to the blackboard?
Can't that thing turn around over there? Can it point to that? I mean, that's too small. No, that one, that camera. Yeah, that you can see. Today, I'm just going to show you a formula that comes up in free probability.
Right.
That's very similar to what you've got. There were planar objects. I mean, you've got tensors, so this wouldn't be the same formula. I don't know if that's visible. This picture over here.
You are a bit far, I'm sorry. Can somebody move the camera closer? Just bring it closer.
Oh, okay. It may be we're pushing the technology. Okay. Yeah, pin the organizer's camera.
Ah, that this looks a bit better. Yes, this I do see a bit better now.
Okay. We can't see what you can see, but anyway, here's the idea is that
here you know what, I will stop sharing. Oh, and I will try to make you big.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So
yeah. Okay. So here's the question. So here you have some A's and B's which are freely independent. I mean the A's are free from the B's.
Okay.
And now they're mixed, so they alternate. But by freeness, you can disentangle them, not in the sense that you're using, but you can separate them so that the A's only interact with each other and the B's only interact with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And you do it by, it's a sum over non-crossing partitions. And I did one picture here. I was just showing this to Alex before your talk, so this by chance happened to be on the board. And the A's are here, 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 and here, A1, A2, A3, A4. And I have a block of size 3. Mm-hmm. And then I look at these gaps, and then I put the B's in gaps. And here I have a B1 on its own, so I get kappa 1 of B1. Here I have a B2 on its own, so I get a kappa 1 of B2. Now I have a B3 and a B4, so I get a kappa 2 of B3, B4. So mm-hmm. These are the free cumulants. And these are just they're traces. I mean, what you're calling traces. And you get this from Weingarten convolution, because initially you separate it out to moments, but you have the Weingarten function in between these two things. And the Weingarten function turns into the Möbius function in the large limit. And the Möbius function turns moments into cumulants.
Yes.
So in the limit, it just boils down to that.
Yes.
So I don't know if, but this doesn't involve any tensors. This is just D no, equals one.
But let's put it like this: the generalization of this, it is ongoing.
Yeah.
So we do encounter non-crossing partitions in this business, and we are trying to actually build, some generalization of these free cumulants for tensors, adapted generalization.
Right. So it would involve tensor independence and free independence at the same time. Because you have the tensor products and then you have the free independence, so it's a mixture of independences.
So this is the hope that we are actively trying to do this.
Okay, great. Okay. Any other questions, comments from Zoom? Okay, so Vio back. Yeah. Oh, I'm going to pass the microphone to Octavio here in the back.
So I see that Benoit was one of your co-authors, but he has worked in something called epsilon independence that has both tensor and free, or classical independence and free independence together. So maybe that is related to your ongoing work.
So not really. we are trying to consider the way I see the relationship, which I might be wrong, it's that we are trying to consider a slightly different notion of tensors. So here we are considering a slightly different notion of tensors. So in that particular thing, I think that they are focusing on tensor products, tensor beams and tensor products. Whereas here we consider slightly more general tensors.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, any other questions, comments for Razvan? Okay, I don't hear or see any. So let's thank Razvan again.
Okay, thank you for inviting me.
And now we have coffee over here in London.
So have a good coffee.
Yeah, and we'll start at 10:30. Next talk is at 3:00. Thank you very much.
All right. Cheers. Bye.